Okay, well, lymphatics. Let's start. Lymphatics is taught as its own system. I'll start off with a basic question. What is lymph? Lymph is the fluid of lymphatics. I've got a picture here of what happens when lymphatics doesn't work. And I also have some, the answer to the question, what is lymph? It's fluid. And know where it comes from. Lymph is fluid that collects in the tissues from capillary exchange. Now, when I taught that, I didn't really emphasize it, but you have the filtration and absorption of fluids. Fluids are exchanged. I talked about the hydrostatic and osmotic pressures, right? How they counteract each other. But what I emphasized was that there's like more that's filtered out at the arterial end than is absorbed at the venous end. So those excess fluids need to be transported back to the blood. And if lymphatics doesn't absorb that excess fluid that collects in the tissues, edema results, or swelling. This is a condition called elephantiasis, which is when lymph nodes become clogged with parasites and it can't circulate the excess fluids back to the venous blood. That's what you see there. So that's how it's generated. Lymph is fluid that collects in tissues from capillary exchange. Is that leftover fluid, okay? Lymphatics, there are two major functions of lymphatics. I'll just kind of tell you outright. One is circulation, the other is immunity. These are the two basic functions. Because of the extremities you see there, you can see why it functions in circulation. That's what happens when lymphatics fail. You can appreciate that it functions in immunity. The main cells of the lymphatic system are the lymphocytes. So the lymphatic vessels have leaky walls. They're going to absorb the excess fluid called the lymph. That's the circulation function. So what I'm writing is circulation function, excess fluids picked up by lymphatics. Lymphatics are vessels, just like blood vessels, except they're transporting lymph, not blood. Okay. Those excess fluids are lymph. So that fluid would be clearer white, okay? Because, you know, it's not blood, it's just fluid, and it's got white blood cells in it, so it might maybe a whitish color. So the smallest lymphatics are lymphatic capillaries. That's shown here. Green is used to symbolize lymphatics in textbooks, and I don't know why the green was designated the color. Lymphatics are probably white if you look at them in a cadaver, white or clear because of the white blood cells. But they're illustrated green, and it makes it easy to see. So you can see the lymphatic circulation begins at the blood capillary level. That's where all the excess tissues are accumulating. Is lymphatic circulation begins with lymphatic capillaries in the tissues. That's where the fluids first enter the lymphatics at the capillary level. So you have blood capillaries, not to be confused with the lymphatic capillaries. All the green stuff around the blood capillary that show on the big picture there. So the lymphatic capillaries will then drain into larger and larger lymphatic structures. Some of the larger lymphatic vessels are called trunks. The largest lymphatic vessels are called ducts. Okay. And notice a couple of things about lymphatics. They have valves, they're like venous valves, right? And they have lymph nodes. Lymphatic trunks drain lymph to lymphatic ducts. The ducts are the biggest lymphatic structures. And along the way, lymphatic structures, you know, like the ducts, like the trunks, you have these internal valves. They're like semilunar valves. They're like the SL valves that ensure one-way flow. And they also have many lymphocytes and lymph nodes in series before you get back to the venous blood. I'll say lymph passes through several lymph nodes before entering venous blood. That's kind of what you're supposed to see at the figure on the left. They're showing you where lymphatics begins, lymphatic capillaries. Larger structures will collect that lymph, filter it through lymph nodes before you get back to the venous blood. Okay. And so by filtering the lymph through lymph nodes, that's an immune function because lymph nodes are packed out with whole lymphocytes. We'll take a look at a closer look at a lymph node later. But let's look at some of the anatomy of the actual ducts you gotta know. I don't have too much in terms of structures for you to know about lymphatics. You should know they're everywhere, as illustrated here. The big vessels that carry lymph are right lymphatic duct, thoracic duct, cisterna chyli. Those are the ones I'll note. The region of the body highlighted in this pale green are the areas served by the right lymphatic duct. All the lymph from those body regions drain to that one duct. Right lymphatic duct. Receives lymph from region colored green on the figure. So refer to the figure. You get the idea. right upper limb, right pectoral region, head and neck region on the right side. Okay, basically, all else, all other lymph, drains into cisterna chyli and thoracic duct. Important lymphatic structures. You can tell regionally from the picture that cisterna chyli is getting all the lymph from the lower half of the body, going right into the thoracic duct, which is in the mediastinum. Okay, well, you should know that right lymphatic duct and thoracic duct, they're both draining into this little venous angle here, right there. Let me show you a close-up picture of it. Let's go here. You should know this anatomy. What you got here is the subclavian vein on the right side, right internal jugular vein. That little angle right there is where they drain into. This confused a lot of students on the lab practical. Some of you thought I put a sticker here. You put the wrong answer. I put it down here. That's superior vein cava. That was the correct answer. But you thought I put it here. And you put brachiocephalic vein, that was incorrect. Okay, so for this, but that's kind of that angle, what's called the venous angle. That's where you expect to find thoracic duct, right lymphatic duct draining to. Lymph delivered to the venous angle created by the IJV and subclavian vein. I'll just abbreviate them. By now you know they already studied them. So that's the anatomy of lymphatics, where they are. And I do want to show you those little capillaries. So where it all begins. That's where it all ends. This is where it all begins. These are like, it's a microscopic illustration of a lymphatic capillary. You can kind of see how the cells overlap. So this is basically showing students how lymph enters lymphatic capillaries. What they're showing you here is that the cells, they kind of do this overlap thing. And what they show you is the overlapping edge of kind of one cell will be stiff. And that allows one edge to kind of flap open. So it acts as kind of like a valve when it flaps open. That'll allow fluids to enter. They call this valve a flap-like mini valve, or sometimes they're called the primary valve. It's the first valve that lets the fluid in, hence primary. So note this as primary valve. Sometimes I refer to them as the flap-like mini valve. Okay, so once the fluid gets in, that's shown at the figure at the top. The same thing I just drew is shown at the top here. Let me kind of zoom in on what I'm talking about here. kind of like the cells overlap, but one cell flaps open, fluids get in, just like I drew, right? Fluids get in, okay? They call this the expansion phase. Don't worry about that. I just want you to know how fluids get in. Now, once fluids get in, you got to push it forward. And so you compress this structure, and you push it forward through the semilunar valve. That's a secondary valve or internal valve. Okay. That'll keep fluid going in one direction. I'm just gonna pull back out here. They call this the compression phase. When you compress the vessel, what it does is it closes off the primary valve so no more gets in. And you're just pushing the fluid inside forward through the internal valve. So we'll write that down. Once lymph has entered, lymphatics are compressed. Pushing lymph forward through these internal valves. So in my illustration, I guess I could add to it. So like an internal valve here. You can compress and then push the fluids forward through the internal valve. Are compressed, pushing lymph forward through internal valves. Sometimes the internal valves are considered secondary valves, since primary valves needs a secondary. Basically how lymph gets in. For the immune function, let's go ahead and talk about that after break. Let's take a break now and talk about the immune function of lymphatics.